Welcome welcome to my YouTube channel. Today my video is on the topic human respiratory system. First we will study the anatomy of the respiratory system. These are the lungs, pink color. These are the rib cage which protect the lungs. This is the diaphragm. This is the trachea. The diaphragm contracts while we breathe in and the diaphragm relaxes while we breathe out. Next, what do you understand by respiration and breathing? Both the term respiration and breathing have the same meaning. Respiration is just breathing in the air and breathing out the air. When we inhale, we take the oxygen from the atmospheric air, and when we breathe out, we exhale the carbon dioxide from our body. So there are various organs which are used as respiratory system in various animals. For example, in humans, lungs are used as the respiratory system. Like that, gills are used by the aquatic arthropods, mollusks, fishes as the respiratory organ. Lung is used by the reptiles, birds and mammals as their respiratory organ. Tracheal tubes is used by insect. But in the invertebrates like sponges, cylindrids, flatworms, they are the simple organisms, so that's why they just use the diffusion process for the exchange of gases. There is no complex organ present inside their body. What is the mechanism of respiration? There are just 5 steps to understand the mechanism of respiration. The first step is the atmospheric air is drawn in and the carbon dioxide rich alveolar air is released out. When we breathe in, the atmospheric air goes inside our body, and when we breathe out, the carbon dioxide present in our lungs is exhaled out. Second is the diffusion of gases of oxygen and carbon dioxide across alveolar membrane. The diffusion of gases take place in the lungs from the alveoli to the blood, and the oxygen moves from lungs to blood and the carbon dioxide moves from the blood to the lungs. Third is the transport of gases. These gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide, is transported by the blood, which the blood is circulated by the heart throughout our body. Fourth step is diffusion of oxygen and CO2 between blood and tissues. The oxygen and CO2 is diffused further between the blood and tissue. When the blood from the lung is carried to the tissue, then the oxygen moves from blood to the tissue and the carbon dioxide moves from tissue to the blood. Further, the fifth step is the utilization of oxygen by cells for catabolic reaction and resultant release of carbon dioxide. When the oxygen moves from the blood to the cell, then the cell uses the oxygen for catabolic reactions and releases the carbon dioxide. These are the terms which are used in respiration. First is tidal volume. Tidal volume is the volume of air which is inspired or expired during normal respiration. And inspiratory reserve volume is how much of air we can breathe in forcibly. That is inspiratory reserve volume. Expiratory reserve volume is how much amount of air we can expire, we can breathe out. And residual volume is the remaining amount of air which is present inside our lungs after exhaling out the air. Inspiratory capacity, expiratory capacity. This is the capacity of our lungs of how much we can inspire after expiration and how much we can expire after inspiration. That is expiratory capacity. Vital capacity. Vital capacity is the volume of air breathed in after forced expiration. How much air we can inhale after exhaling. That is vital capacity. Functional residual capacity. That is the air remaining in our lung after exhaling out air. Next is the exchange of gases in humans. This diagram shows the exchange of gases take place inside our body. There are 2 places where exchange of gases take place. First is between the alveoli and the blood. Second is between the blood and the tissues. Into the alveoli, the air diffuses on the basis of partial pressure of oxygen. That means the amount of oxygen present in a mixture of gases. The PO2 is more in alveoli. That's why the O2 diffuses from alveoli to blood. And the PCO2 is low in alveoli, so the CO2 diffuses from blood to the alveoli. Same process take place between the tissue and the blood. Artery, this carry the pure blood. and this pure blood carry the oxygen. So O2 is more in this red blood artery, and the O2 diffuses into the tissues, because the O2 is more in the blood than the tissue. So the O2 diffuses from blood to tissues, and in the tissues carbon dioxide more, so carbon dioxide diffuses from the tissues to the blood. Then this impure blood, this through the systematic vein, it is carried to the heart. Then from the heart through the pulmonary artery, it is carried to the lungs. The CO2 diffuses into the alveoli, then it is exhaled out, expired. There are two gases which are transported through the blood in our body. First is oxygen and CO2. The transportation of these gases in our blood is carried by one red pigment, that is hemoglobin. When the oxygen binds with the hemoglobin, then it is known as oxyhemoglobin. When the carbon dioxide binds with that hemoglobin, that is carbaminohemoglobin, 97% of the oxygen is carried by the RBC and 3% of oxygen is carried by the plasma. 20-25% of the carbon dioxide is carried by RBC, and the 70% of the carbon dioxide is transported in the form of bicarbonates through the blood. There is one enzyme, carbonic anhydrase. It helps in the transportation of carbon dioxide in the blood. When the carbon dioxide from the tissues diffuses into the blood, then this enzyme carbonic anhydrase changes the CO2 into the bicarbonate HCO3 and H plus ion. And then the blood reaches to the lungs, then the carbonic anhydrase convert the bicarbonate into the CO2 and H2, so that the CO2 from the blood could diffuses into the lung, and then it will be exhaled out. Next is the oxygen dissociation curve. This is a graph which help us in understanding how much amount of oxygen is associated with hemoglobin and how much amount of oxygen is dissociated with hemoglobin. If the graph goes into the left side, that means the oxygen association is more, and if the graph curve goes into the right side, that means the oxygen dissociation is more. And these are the factors which help in understanding the dissociation curve of the oxygen, that is pH, DPG, temperature. When the pH is more, then the H plus ion are low, DPG is low, temperature is low, so it will help in the formation of oxyhemoglobin more. And when the pH is less, that means H plus ion are more, DPG is more, temperature more, then it will help in the increase in the percentage of oxygen dissociation with the hemoglobin. Next is the regulation of respiration. There are two centers which regulate our respiratory system. First is present in the medulla region of our brain, that is respiratory rhythm center, and second is present in the pons region in our brain, that is pneumotaxis center. And these centers are activated by the increase in level of carbon dioxide and H plus ion. When these two things are increased, carbon dioxide and H plus ion, it activate the center and it will regulate our respiration system. Next is disorder of respiratory system. Is the asthma, and second is occupational respiratory disorder, third is emphysema. In asthma, the bronchioles are the tubes which are connected to the alveoli in our lungs. The tubes shrink, so there is a difficulty while breathing in. Second is the occupational respiratory disorder. These are the disorder in which there is difficulty in breathing, but it occur in the person which work in an industry or factory where the pollution is more. In emphysema disorder, the alveoli is outer layer sheds off, so there is the loss of the alveoli. There is less alveoli which help in the respiration. Okay guys, ending my video with this. Hope you like my video. If you like my video, like, share and subscribe.